Chapter 10. Hey, pronounce your H's. In this chapter, we're going to continue our look at the vowels in the alphabet. We've looked at the history of the letters A and O. Each of those had a more or less independent history. But the history of the other vowels is closely tied to other letters of the alphabet. So now let's turn to the letter E and its connection to the letter H. One connection between the letters E and H should be obvious if you think about it. Consider words like taste, change, mouse, time, and bake. These words are like hundreds of common everyday words in modern English that have an E at the end, which we don't pronounce. Modern English is filled with words that have a silent and seemingly unnecessary E. And now think about words like honor, honest, and hour, as in time of day. All of these words have an H at the beginning, which is also not pronounced. So we have silent H's. And at least in American English, we can add the word herb, as in a seasoning. So just as we have silent E's in modern English, we sometimes get silent H's. What you might not know is that the letter E actually began as an H sound. So in that sense, both letters can be traced back to the same ultimate source. So let's look to the original Phoenician alphabet. Today, the letter E is the fifth letter of our alphabet. But as we know by now, the Phoenicians didn't have vowels in their alphabet. They only had consonants. So the fifth letter of the Phoenician alphabet was a consonant, and it was actually an H sound. The letter was pronounced as hey by the Phoenicians. And here's an interesting fact. It actually meant hey in the Phoenician language, as in, hey, look here, or hey, how are you? Remember that the Phoenicians gave their letters names based on the sound which the letter represented. So since this fifth letter represented an H sound, it was named hey, which began with that sound. And the original symbol for the letter was based on that word. So since the word hey meant hey, the original symbol for the letter was basically a depiction of a stick figure with its arms held up in the air at right angles, as if it was saying hey. And we can still see that original stick figure in the modern letter E if we look close enough. If we take a modern uppercase E and tilt it on its back, so basically turn it counterclockwise about 90 degrees, with the long straight line lying horizontally and the three short lines sticking up in the air, you can see the remnants of that original stick figure. The middle line represents the figure's head, and the two other lines represent the arms up in the air, saying, hey. Over time, the figure's head and legs were dropped, and the main part of the body, with the arms held out at right angles, remained. So this basically looked like a modern letter E lying on its back. That letter was then tilted on its side to create the modern letter E. So the shape and the alphabet position of the modern letter E is directly descended from that original Phoenician letter, he. But remember that this letter was the consonant H sound in the original Phoenician alphabet, because the Phoenicians didn't have vowel letters. Now, as we know, the modern letter H is the eighth letter of the alphabet. And this letter also began with the Phoenicians. The eighth letter of the Phoenician alphabet represented a K sound, or a CH sound, as in the word bak. And it was a very breathy K sound. Remember from our earlier discussion of the K sound that the Phoenicians had several K sounds, including the original versions of the modern letters K and Q. Well, here was another one. The eighth letter of the Phoenician alphabet was called ket, and that word basically meant fence in the Phoenician language. And like most of those original Phoenician letters, the symbol for the letter was designed to resemble the word it was named after, so the original letter resembled a fence. But interestingly, instead of it being turned horizontally like you would expect a fence to look, the Phoenician letter was turned vertically, so it actually looked more like a ladder. If you imagine two squares, one on top of the other, that was basically the original version of the letter H, or ket, in the Phoenician alphabet. because of its position and shape, some historians think the symbol may have been turned on its side at some point early on. Or perhaps it was actually intended to represent a segment or a portion of a fence, basically two poles with ropes or boards extending between them. At any rate, this basic shape has actually changed very little over the years. By the time the Romans adopted the letter, the horizontal line at the very top and the very bottom had been dropped, and that left us with the modern uppercase letter H. So in review, the original Phoenician fifth letter, which became E, it had the H sound originally. And the eighth letter, which became H, it originally had a very breathy K sound. Both were consonants. But around 800 BC, the Greeks adopted the alphabet. And remember, they needed to create letters for vowels. And also remember, in creating those new vowel letters, they didn't just make up new letters. They chose to use existing letters, which represented sounds that didn't exist in Greek. And now the Greeks needed to create a letter for the vowel E sound, which was actually pronounced A in Greek. And it's still the long E sound in continental Europe. And it was here that the Greeks did something very interesting. The Greeks actually had an H sound in their language. So that fifth letter, which was the Phoenician H sound, seems like a natural choice for the Greek H sound. It would have worked just fine in Greek. And the Greeks didn't have a breathy K sound as represented by that eighth letter. So that would have been a good letter to use for the E sound. And if they had done that, then probably today the fifth letter would be the H sound, and the eighth letter would be the E sound. But of course, the opposite is the case today. So what happened? Well, the answer to that question may lie in the very nature of the sound represented by the letter H. You see, the H sound isn't really a proper sound or phoneme, which we typically associate with the other letters. It's really more just a breathy sound we make before certain other letters. So if we say the word house, it's really just the word aus with a slight breathy sound at the beginning. So it becomes house. That h is really the sound of H. And since it's really just a breathy sound, there's a tendency for some speakers to simply drop that sound altogether sometimes, as we'll see later. So it is a consonant, but it's a very weak consonant, linguistically speaking. So that fifth letter in the Phoenician alphabet was called he. That meant it was a very breathy huh sound followed by a. And that eighth letter was ket, which had that very breathy k sound, k. So both letters were breathy, and therefore they both had characteristics of the h sound within them. But the Greeks were looking for a letter to represent the Greek vowel, E, which remember was pronounced A by the Greeks. As you may remember from earlier chapters, English has shifted the vowel sounds around. But in a word like café, which has been borrowed from French, the E at the end still represents that original continental sound of E, which was actually A. And again, the Greeks were looking for a letter to represent this sound. And here was this fifth letter, hey. It seemed like a natural choice. Its name was already A, with that little breathy sound before it to make it hey. So this appears to be why the early Greeks chose this fifth letter, hey, for the A sound of the original E. And that eighth letter was a very breathy K sound, k. So it had aspects of both a K sound and an H sound. But the Greeks already had the early versions of the letters K and Q, so the K sound was well covered by those letters. So they didn't need the eighth letter for the K sound. So that seemed like a good letter to use for the H sound, since it already had a breathy sound reminiscent of an H sound. So in essence, a switcheroo occurred. The H letter at position number 5 became the E letter, later called epsilon. And the breathy K letter at position number 8 became the H letter, heta. And that's basically the way the alphabet passed to the Etruscans and later to the Romans. But the Greeks eventually completed this switcheroo within later Greek. eighth letter, heta, eventually became a short E sound within Greek. So by the time of later Greek, the original H letter had become the long E letter, epsilon, and the later H letter, heta, had become the short E letter, eta. So both H letters eventually became E letters in Greek. And in order to represent the H sound, later Greek simply used an accent mark. And this reflects a very important fact about the sound of the letter H. Again, it's a very weak consonant. The later Greeks didn't even feel that it needed a letter. An accent mark was sufficient. And as we'll soon see, that H sound, it even tends to completely disappear over time. But before we look at the disappearing H, let's look at the version of the Greek alphabet adopted by the Etruscans. By around 700 BC, the changes in the early Greek alphabet had produced the original versions of our modern letters E and H. The fifth letter, epsilon, now represented the E sound with a shape based on that early stick figure with its hands up, but was now evolving into our modern letter E. And the eighth letter, heta, had the H sound, and the Greeks were already beginning to simplify that fence shape, which looked like two squares on top of each other, by deleting the top and bottom lines, so the modern letter H was emerging from heta, which later became H. And it was at this point that the alphabet passed to the Etruscans. So the eventual transition of the H-sounding heta into the E-sounding eta happened later in the Greek alphabet, so it didn't affect the version of the alphabet which was adopted by the Etruscans. The Etruscans basically took the Greek alphabet at the time when the fifth letter was the version of E and the eighth letter was the version of H. The general shapes of the letters, the sounds they represented, and their position in the alphabet were basically set. And they passed into the Roman alphabet and into our modern alphabet in the same form. And this gives us the modern letters E and H. But there were some more changes to come. Let's first look at what happened to the letter E after the Romans adopted the alphabet. Even though the later Greeks adopted two separate E letters, epsilon and eta, for the short E sound, e, and the long E sound, a, the early Greeks just used the fifth letter, the early epsilon, for both sounds. And so letter E passed to the Etruscans and the Romans, serving this double duty. In fact, all of our modern English vowels have to serve that double duty, or even triple duty, as I mentioned in the earlier discussion with regard to the letter A. So up until the late 1400s, the letter E represented both original E sounds, the short E sound, e, and the long E sound, a, as in cafe. But then English experienced that vowel shift, when the pronunciation of all the vowels began to shift around. And it was at that point that the E lost its A sound, and it got the new E sound, which is, of course, the modern long E sound. The original A sound shifted over to letter A, thus its name today. And up to this point, the E sound had been the sound of the letter I. Think about a word like pizza, which comes from Italian and still has that I with the original E sound. But now that sound shifted over to the letter E. So you see how this gets really complicated. But the bottom line here is that the letter E now got a brand new long sound, E, and it retained its short A sound as well. But why do we have all of those silent E's? Well, in some cases, the silent E is a holdover from a time when the E was pronounced, but it's no longer pronounced. But as I discussed in the earlier chapter on letters A and O, the letter E is often used in modern English as a marker to indicate that a preceding vowel is long. During the period of earlier Middle English, the vowels could be short or long, just like today. But scribes didn't know how to make it clear to the reader whether the vowel was short or long. So words like hat and hate would have to be spelled the same way, H-A-T. And bit and bite would have to be spelled the same way, B-I-T. So the Middle English scribes adopted a general rule of adding the letter E to the end of a word to indicate that the preceding vowel was pronounced as a long vowel. So to distinguish hat from hate, the scribes would leave off the E for the short vowel, which is a. So no E meant hat. But to indicate the long vowel version, hate, the E was added to the end. And the same was done for bit and bite. No E meant the vowel stayed short, I. So bit. But to make the vowel long, you had to add the E at the end. Therefore, bite. The point here is that when the E is used in this manner, it's not representing an actual E, or any particular sound for that matter. It's merely acting as a marker. Those Middle English scribes could have inserted a symbol, kind of like the French did with the accent aigu, the little line above the E to indicate that it's pronounced long, like in café. But they didn't do that. They simply made the letter E do that job by adding it to the end. And while that worked, it unfortunately made modern English spelling much more complicated. And of course, if English had developed separate letters for the vowels, like Greek eventually did with the short epsilon and long eta in the case of E, well, then modern English wouldn't need all those silent E's at the end of words to distinguish the long and short vowels. But alas, nobody ever said English spelling was intended to be easy. I should remind you at this point that the lowercase versions of the letters began to emerge in the Middle Ages. These versions of the letters initially represented quicker ways to write the letters with ink, basically like an early form of cursive writing. Initially, there were no uppercase and lowercase letters. All letters were considered the same. These were just convenient, quick versions. And this is also how the lowercase e emerged. Think of an uppercase e as a little line in the middle surrounded by a box on three sides. These early scribes would write the middle line of the E first, and then, to represent the box that surrounds it on the top and left and bottom, they would simply draw a curvy C shape around that initial line to represent the surrounding box. And if you make this motion with one stroke without lifting the quill or the pen, then you have the shape that became lowercase e. So that's E. What about H? Remember that the eighth Greek letter, heta, passed to the Etruscans and the Romans, representing the H sound. And also remember that H sound was a very weak consonant. It was basically just a breathy sound before another letter. The fact that H is a somewhat unconventional letter means that it's been used in some unconventional ways by scribes through the ages. And many of these uses have passed down to us in modern English. Let's keep in mind that alphabets don't necessarily represent all of the sounds or phonemes in a particular language. There are often sounds which have to be represented in other ways, typically by combining certain letters to represent those sounds. And through the centuries, the letter H has often been used for that purpose. Largely because of its weak, breathy nature, it can be easily combined with other letters to represent new sounds. And this was something that the Romans started doing during the period of classical Latin. It was a technique which the Romans developed because they were routinely borrowing words from Greek, which had sounds that didn't exist in Latin. So let's take a look back to the Greeks for a moment. After the initial Greek alphabet was adopted by the Greeks, some regional Greek dialects added some additional letters to their respective alphabets. But these additional letters didn't pass to the Etruscans or the Romans, so these were exclusively Greek letters. But many years later, when the Romans borrowed some of the Greek words into Latin, they had to figure out how to represent those Greek sounds without those Greek letters. For example, the Greeks had a later breathy K sound represented by a Greek letter called chi. It's typically spelled in modern English as K-H-I, but the sound would have been chi in the original Greek dialects. The Romans didn't have that sound, or the letter chi. So since it was a breathy or aspirated K sound, the Romans combined the letters C and H, the C being the traditional K letter in Latin, and the H representing the breathy sound. And this CH letter combination is still found in modern English in the spelling of words like chrome, chronic, choir, and chorus, where CH is used for the K sound. Similarly, the Greeks had developed a letter called rho, which had a very breathy R sound. And again, Latin didn't have that exact letter or sound. So to represent that breathy R sound, they combined the letter R with the letter H. Again, this meant breathy R in Latin, and we still see that RH spelling in words like rhinoceros, rhetoric, or rhythm. Along the same lines, the Greeks developed a sound between a P sound and an F sound. In some of the Greek dialects, it had a very aspirated or breathy P sound. So the Greeks called the new letter phi. This letter is typically spelled in modern English as P-H-I. But again, during the time of the original Greeks, it would have been pronounced phi. Again, the Romans later borrowed Greek words with this Greek letter. So they had to determine how to write it in Latin. And using the same general approach, they combined a P with a breathy H to create the PH letter combination. I mentioned that this sound was between a P sound and an F sound in some Greek dialects. Well, it appears that this sound was actually in transition. Linguists have noted that the P sound sometimes shifts to an F sound in certain languages. That actually happened in the early Germanic languages, which ultimately produced English among other languages. And that's why English has father with an F, where Latin has pater with a P. And English has foot with an F, where Latin has pod with a P. Well, this sound also shifted in many Greek words. And this Greek letter phi was created at a time when the letter was in transition. And that's why it's difficult to pinpoint the exact sound of the letter during this period of Greek. But we know that the sound eventually completed this transition by the period of Classical Latin. So when the Romans adopted many Greek words with this Greek letter phi, those words were generally being pronounced with the F sound. But the Romans wanted to preserve the Greek spelling with the Greek letter phi. So they used that letter combination PH for those words. And as I noted, that PH combination represented the F sound by this point in those words, and it continues to represent the F sound in those words which have a PH and have passed into modern English. The Greeks also had a TH sound in many of their words. In order to represent that sound, the Greeks later developed the letter theta. Well, that TH sound didn't exist in Latin. So the Romans created the combination TH to represent that sound in words that were being borrowed from Greek. And again, this letter is passed into modern English. And in fact, it's very prominent in modern English because Old English had the TH sound. And a lot of those Old English words have passed into modern English. In fact, Old English had two separate letters to represent the TH sound. The Anglo-Saxons recognized the distinction between the TH sound of a word like the and the TH sound of a word like thin. So they actually had separate letters for each sound. But after the Norman French invaded England in 1066, the lingering Anglo-Saxon letters of Old English were discarded, and in their place, the Middle English scribes adopted the Roman TH letter combination to represent those sounds. And speaking of Old English, there were lots of sound changes happening during that original period of English. For example, take the letter G. As I discussed in an earlier chapter, the hard G sound, G, shifted to a soft G sound, J, before the letters E and I, the front vowels. And this happened in early French. And many of these words eventually found their way into English after the Norman invasion. And similarly, the hard K sound of the letter C shifted to an S sound before those same letters, E and I. And again, that happened in Old French, and many of those words passed into Middle English. The pronunciation of these two letters, C and G, changed throughout the Romance languages during this period. Well, they also changed in Old English. The hard G sound, developed a very breathy G sound and sometimes a Y sound, y, before E and I in Old English. For example, the word year comes from an Old English word where it was pronounced very similarly to the way it's pronounced today, but it was spelled G-E-A-R, not Y-E-A-R. That G sometimes had this breathy G or Y sound, or G-Y sound, which was distinct from the typical hard G sound. And so Anglo-Saxon scribes developed a special Old English letter to represent that sound. This new letter was called Yog. It looks something like a cross between a lowercase g and the number 3. In fact, it looked a lot like a modern lowercase cursive letter Z. Well, when the Norman French scribes arrived in England after 1066, they hated the Anglo-Saxon letter Yog. So, like the other unique Old English letters, they got rid of it and replaced it with a new letter combination. And guess what the new combination was? It was G plus H. Remember that Yog letter represented a sound that was sometimes a Y sound and sometimes more of a breathy G sound, maybe an in-between G-Y sound. So the best way to represent that sound using Roman letters was with letter G plus the breathy letter H. That gave us the G-H spelling, which we still have in words like sight, night, although, cough, and enough. Initially, these spellings reflected the way those words were pronounced. But over time, this G-H sound has largely been lost in modern English, and it's disappeared over time, as in the case of words like sight and night, or it's shifted to other sounds, like the F sound in words like cough and enough. And just as the nature of the letter G changed before the front vowels, E and I, in Old English, so did the letter C. In Old English, the hard K sound of the letter C tended to shift to a CH sound, ch, before the E and the I. So in Old English, a word like killed or killed was spelled C-I-L-D, and that word eventually became the word child. The original Germanic word for kitchen was coquina, and that word passed into Old English as kitchena, with a CH sound in the middle. And the Germanic word for church was charika, which passed into Old English as charicha. So again, the Norman French scribes inherited all of these Anglo-Saxon words from Old English with a letter C, but a CH pronunciation. And remember, the pronunciation of C was already confusing enough. Thanks to the French, a C before an A, O, or U was pronounced as a K, but a C before an E or an I was pronounced as an S. And these are still the general rules which we have today. But now, here was a third sound for the letter C, the CH sound in all of those Old English words. And once again, the letter H came to the rescue. The French-influenced scribes of Middle English introduced the letter combination CH to represent this sound, ch, which we now know as the CH sound. And all of the Old English words with that sound, like the early versions of child and kitchen and church, well, they received brand new spellings with a C and an H, just as we know them today. Now, keep in mind that this was the second time this CH letter combination had been introduced. You may remember from earlier that the Romans tried to duplicate an aspirated K sound of the Greeks by using the letter combination of C and H. So, as a very general rule in modern English, when the CH combination has a K sound, in words like chrome, chronic, choir, or chorus, for example, we're looking at Greco-Roman words which date back to this period when the Romans used CH to represent the breathy K sound of the Greeks. And when the CH letter combination has the ch sound, the CH sound, it typically represents words that were inherited from Old English and dates back to the period when the French-influenced scribes in England introduced the letter combination for the CH sound. Of course, these are general rules because many words have been adopted into modern English from other languages, and the CH spelling may appear in more recently borrowed words as well, but we don't usually use the CH for the K sound today, except in those old Greco-Roman words, which are still found in modern English. So we can see how this weak consonant H is so prominent in modern English. It's been used in conjunction with other letters to represent sounds which are not represented by existing letters. We can also add the SH letter combination to the list as well for the SH sound. But ironically, at the same time the letter H has snuck into many English words as the partner of another letter, the H sound itself has also disappeared from many words. And this disappearance of the H sound has to do with its very nature. As we've seen, the H sound is basically just a breathy sound, and it occurs in front of all sorts of letters. But because of its weak, breathy nature, sometimes people simply stop pronouncing it altogether. And this basic aspect of the H sound had lots of consequences for Latin and the Romance languages and later English. Take Latin, for example. As we've seen, classical Latin had the H sound as represented by the letter H. But by around the 3rd century AD, during the late Latin period, the H sound had disappeared from Latin. So before Latin fractured into the various Romance languages, the H sound was gone. And that meant French doesn't have, and it's never had, the H sound. But during the Middle Ages, French scribes were busy writing down these French words in this relatively new French language. And since a lot of these words came from Latin, the words often retained their Latin H in the French spellings, even though the H wasn't being pronounced. And after the Norman invasion of England in 1066, a lot of these French words passed into English with their H spellings, but without the H sound. So words like honor, honest, hour, as in the time of day, heir, as in someone who inherits property, and herb were spelled with their silent H. These silent H's are a direct inheritance from French and reflect the H sound that was lost in late Latin. Now, like Latin, English also lost the H sound in certain words. For example, in Old English, it was common for the H sound to precede the W sound in words like what, when, and white. So it was more like what, when, and white. And the spelling of those words in Old English reflected that pronunciation. So those words were spelled with an HW at the beginning. But the H sound eventually disappeared, leaving the W as the primary sound. So basically, we ended up with the pronunciations which we have today, without the H sound. And to reflect the loss of the H sound, Middle English scribes reversed the initial letters in those words so that instead of HW, the words now begin with WH. This spelling reflects the fact that the W sound is now the primary consonant at the beginning. But just as French scribes kept the Latin H in words where the H sound was no longer being pronounced, the Middle English scribes did the same thing. So it indicates that these scribes were more concerned about maintaining a link to the past than trying to accurately reflect the way the words were pronounced at the time. And this legacy has passed through English and given us many spellings that seem unusual today. Often, it isn't that they're unusual as much as it's just they're antiquated. This tendency of the H sound to disappear became a big class issue in England in the 19th century. Within certain stigmatized dialects, like the London Cockney accent, it became commonplace to drop the H sound. So hello became hello, and house became ouse, and humble became humble. And this tendency to drop H's became a sign of one's lower class. And perhaps in response to this, many of these same speakers began to arbitrarily add H's to words where the H didn't belong. So instinct became henstinct, and extra became hextra, and off became hoff. There was a movement in some circles to correct this bad English, quote-unquote, by reinserting and pronouncing the H in words where it had been dropped. The problem was that silent H, which English had inherited from French in words like honor, honest, hour, and herb. In their zeal to reinsert the H sound in words which supposedly lower-class Brits had stopped pronouncing, some Victorian-era Brits accidentally started pronouncing the H in some old French words where the H had never been pronounced, at least not since the period of French. I mean, at that point in time, it wasn't always clear if the missing H had always been missing or if it was a recent lower-class development. So sometimes words got a brand new H sound if they were spelled with an H, even if the H sound had never been pronounced in English before. And so this is why British English pronounces H-E-R-B as herb, but American English pronounces it as herb without the H. It was actually always pronounced as herb, which is the French pronunciation, and that's the pronunciation that passed from England to the American colonies in the 1600s and 1700s. But it was in the 1800s that many English speakers in Britain began to pronounce the H at the beginning of the word because they thought it was one of those H's that had been improperly dropped by the bad English accents. So even though American English didn't insert the H sound as much as British English did, it did add H's to words from time to time. So words like hotel and history were originally pronounced without the H sound in early English. But today, the standard pronunciation of those words in both British English and American English is with the H sound. A sure sign of a later inserted H sound at the beginning of a word is whether or not you use a or an at the beginning. Normally, we only use an before a vowel, but an is also sometimes used before a word beginning with a consonant H sound, like an hotel or an historical. And not all English dialects do that, but it's very common. And the reason why that an is often used before certain words that begin with H is because the H was not originally pronounced in French or early English. So an was the proper article originally. But later, the H started to be pronounced. But the old article, an, was often retained just based on tradition. So, an historical became an historical, and that's considered proper English today. So we can see how tricky this letter H is. It's almost like the old cups and ball trick performed by magicians. Now you hear it, now you don't, now you hear it again where it wasn't supposed to be heard. But that's the history of the H sound. And as for the letter H itself, well, it too has a similar history. It was there originally, it became an E, it shifted to another position, and this one too became an E, at least in Greek, and then it was routinely paired with other letters to represent unique sounds. And when all is said and done, the letter H remains one of the most variable and versatile letters in the entire alphabet.